My vision for the future is one in which we have a much more sophisticated understanding of other animal personalities and individual tastes, and that includes music. I think music and music taste is one way of getting at individual differences among other animals. I brought a band, Grass Widow. They're great and based out of San Francisco, to the Franklin Park Zoo in Boston. I came across an article, and it was published in 1897 in a journal called the Musical Times and Singing Class Circular. And this article was called Music for Animals. And basically, it was a rundown of all of the shows for non-human animals, musical shows that have been played throughout the 19th century and a little bit before. And I was totally intrigued by this idea, and I decided that I wanted to do it now. I wanted to do another version of Music for Animals, but to do it contemporarily. One of the most interesting parts was when we first arrived and the gorillas were checking out the instruments and while we were setting up. The fun thing about playing for a non-human show, a non-human audience, is that it doesn't begin when the lights go out. The lights come up on the stage and you hear music. So for the gorillas at the Franklin Park Zoo, it began as soon as they found out there were people at the zoo before it had opened. So the gorillas, they know their schedule extremely well, and they're used to the gates opening at, say, 9:30 a.m. and everyone's there, and before that it's just the keepers, and they know their keepers. So for them, it immediately became interesting that there was a group of other people there. And so they came up and they wanted to know what was going on. So they were interested. A few of them stayed right by the glass where they could see the musicians the best. And one interacted, Kiki. She interacted by actually slamming the glass and kind of becoming part of the music. And then she put her hands up on either side of Raven, the guitarist, and then just like put her ear, you know, kind of on the glass so she could be part of it, I think, and hear more clearly. There's actually a big industry around this. So a lot of times, dogs and cats with separation anxiety problems or fear and anxiety when their main human or another companion leaves them alone, you can buy CDs that you can leave on your CD player, for example, when you leave the house. I think one is called Canine Companion, and they play classical music. And it exists. I'm leery of that because I think even lots of people don't find classical music soothing. Maybe the dog wants to hear the sound of trash cans falling over again and again and again, you know, or the sound of a cat nearby yowling again and again and again. We have no idea what makes them feel more relaxed and interested, the sounds. But I think it's a really exciting and fun way to try it out, and I think it points to individual animal personality. What's at stake when we talk about animal personality is really all of our dealings with non-human animals, and that extends from, you know, the food industry all the way into who we allow to sleep on our bed and then who is on our dinner plate, basically. And I'm not saying that, you know, we shouldn't eat other animals, but, you know, what I do believe is that we should be aware of, you know, who is there. And I think that getting an individual taste and personality shows us that there's a complexity that is not unique to humans alone.